A very warm welcome to all our attendees in today's webinar titled IBM Connections Admin Blast. It is the second of a four-part series that is featuring the Social Connections 12 sessions that the Panagendians held this year in Vienna. My name is Danny, and I'll be assisting Nico in the background in today's webinar. And before I hand it over to him, just a few things that I want to make you aware of. First of all, today's webinar, your microphones will be muted in today's webinar. Nevertheless, we do encourage you to ask any questions that you may have in the questions panel, and we'll make sure to get to them at the end of the webinar. The webinar is scheduled for 60 minutes, which includes this Q&A session. And finally, the presentation will be recorded. Also, it will be shared on our webinar page on our website, the link to which will be sent out to all registrants, whether attending or not, in our follow-up email, which should be distributed later tomorrow. And with that, I'd like to hand it over to you, Nico.
Hi, my name is Nico Meisenthal. I'm consultant at Panagenda. I'm working with Connections since version 3, so around about 2010. I started with Nodes Domino around 2008, and at the moment I'm focused on the whole ICS brand, deploying and doing consultants around of IBM Connections, doing optimization and migrations. I'm with Panagenda since last year, and I'm an IBM champion. Okay, so let's get started with IBM Connections Admin Blast. First tip, IBM released Connections docs version 2.0 CR3 two or three weeks ago. It's a nice new update which includes fixes and also some new features. And you're also able to install the conversion task on Linux, which was Windows only. The time before. So some tips how you do the installation on Linux. First of all, please install and update Connections and viewer parts on your environment. So install Connections 2, docs 2.0, update to CR3 for docs and viewer, and then install the conversion part. So it's only one installer, it will install the Linux parts and all the CR3. The conversion will need a X server environment on your local machine. So be sure and check if start X command is working in your environment, and also if you are installing with a non-root user, be sure to install and configure all requirements and required additional steps, which are mentioned in the documentation. So the X server is really important for the whole conversion stuff. Second one is to install the dependencies. You need Image Magic and some other 32-bit libraries on your Linux conversion host or on every conversion node. Below I'll link to the documentation where you find some deep dive informations. Second one. Bashir services on Linux and Windows. So if you would like to auto-start your environment, you need to create Microsoft Windows services or Linux init scripts to start up your environment, which is pretty nice. To stop your environment using those scripts and services, you need to provide username and password within the configuration. And this might be a security issue because the password for the user is stored as plain text in the init script on Linux, and on Windows it's only encoded, not encrypted. So it's not really secure. I normally create a local WebSphere user and give him only operator rights to use this user within the configuration for the Windows server or Linux script, and stop the user with this defined local user. It's the same issue. You still have the password in plain or only encoded, but at least it's another user which has not full admin rights like WSAdmin or your connections user. And if you define a different password, it's better than doing nothing. So create a local web user and use it for your web services. Third one, servers and connections 6. With connection 6, you need two additional configuration steps when installing connection servers. First one is related to the new Java version. With connection 6, you need Java 1.8. And with Java 1.8, you need to define two additional settings in your Java directory, Java runtime library. And there you need to enable the property file, which I show on the slides, and enable the input and output factory line. Just uncomment the lines and save the file. Please be sure to change the file which is part of the Java 1.8 directory and not the Java directory, because Java is the old Java version 1.6 and Java 1.8 is a new one which is used with connections 6. The second one is related to the WebC plugin and the cache within the WebC plugin. This one needs to be disabled, because if you do not enable it, you will only get an empty page when you access the Forms Experience Builder or the connection surveys. So if you have an empty page, just need to go to your web server configuration, plugin properties, caching, and disable the caching and redeploy your plugin configuration. The issue is not related to the connection service itself or to connection 6. It's related to the fix pick 10 of your WebSphere application server 8.5.5. So it might be also an issue in the future when connections 5.5 will support fix pick 10. So you might need to change this too in the future for connections 5.5. Tip 4, global sender email address. If you configure a new environment or change existing environment and would like to change the notification config, which means the email addresses which are used to send notifications to your users, you have a nice property name, which is global sender email address, and your email address, and always use global sender true, which means that this email address will be used for all notifications which are sent to your users. With connections 5.5, I think it was CR2, there's a small issue, and the global sender email address property will not change the reply to email address. So if your user is getting the email and push the reply button, he will reply to the default value, which is news-admin@example.com. So to be sure that this email address is also changed, I would recommend to change all notification configuration parts and put in your email address in all of them. It's a little bit of work, but if you use regex and I put in an example, it's only one command and you can change all the email addresses in once. Next tip, OrientMe installation cheat sheet. If you would like to install OrientMe, a new environment, here are some useful tips. First of all, you need some mount points. So the first mount point will be used to store persistent data. So the container itself cannot save persistent data. If you delete the container, all data is gone. Because of this, data which is needed within the container will be mounted into the container and will be stored on a network share or on the local file system if it's only a one-node deployment. And the default path, it's the first mount point. So your whole data will be stored in this directory, so you need to be sure that you have enough space. And yeah, I would recommend to define a mount point. Then you can increase or decrease the size as you need it. Second directory, the library directory is used to store all the Docker data. So it's a default Docker directory where the runtime for the containers is stored, where your images are stored. So you need some space here too. Also ORNTme, or at least the stack below ORNTme, which is IBM Cloud Private, will also store the Elastic Data search index and logstash log informations and so on in this directory too, which might be really big. So the second one should be also a mount point, and yeah, said you can increase it and your read directory will not fill up. So it's better to define a second one. The default installation path for all IBM products slash opt is also used with ORNTme, but it's only for the installation directory and for some certificates, so it's not really big. You can define a mount point, but it's not really needed. Second tip, and this is really important, do not use host entries in your ORNTme installation. Why? If you put in a host host configuration on your local machine, you might be able to resolve your connection server or what else what you will put in, but your container or within your container, you will not be able to resolve the entries you put in your host file. So within the container, you only can use a DNS settings. So if you would like to resolve your connections host, it must be part of your DNS. If it's a problem in a test environment or while migrating, doing side-by-side migration, you could fix this issue by deploying a small Linux bind DNS server in one container on your local machine and reconfigure your DNS settings and use this one until you go to production and can change your productive DNS environment. But host entries will not work. For the installation script itself, you are able to use sudo if you are not allowed to access the root user directly, but you will need the root password. So at least you will need your Linux admin to type in the root password while installing. This one is really important. Next one, you will need internet access. And the only supported way to do this is direct internet access. You will need it to download images from Docker Hub. You will need it to download the Kubernetes stuff. Some of the container will use YAM and install content while starting up from the internet. So it's really important to have internet access. And yeah, only supported using direct internet access, but it's also possible to configure a proxy to access the internet, but it's yeah, it's some special work, and I documented it in my blog post, so you can have a look into it. It's not really hard, but you need to do some small changes. Same for changing the admin password. If you change the admin password in the IBM Cloud Private UI, it will work for the IBM Cloud Private stuff, but ORNTme will break, because if you redeploy a pod or a container, it will use your old credentials to download the new image to build a new container. So you need to change the password on two different points. First one is within the Docker CLI, the Docker login, and the second one is a secret file within Kubernetes. So you need to change the password on different parts in your configuration or in your environment to be sure that everything is working. Also for the password changing, I put in some information in my blog post. Next one, WebSphere and 4096 bit SSL keys. If you would like to use a 4069-bit SSL key on an HTTP server, or you're using it on a Domino environment, which is integrated in an iframe or in a, using the mail integration, your WebSphere will have a problem. So WebSphere by default only supports 2048-bit SSL keys. To fix this, you need the unrestricted Java policy, which you can download at the IBM homepage. And you need to copy it over in the Java directory on every node. So, once again, if you use Java 1.8, you need to put this in the Java 1.8 folder. If you use Java 1.6 for connections 5.5 and earlier, you need to put it in the Java directory. And it's really important to recheck and recopy the files after every WebSphere Java update, because the Java update will completely delete the folder and will copy over a new version. So you need to recopy it after every update. Yeah, and after this, you need to do a short restart, and then your WebSphere server is able to connect to servers and hosts which are using 4096-bit SSL keys. Community catalog status URL. Yeah, this is a really nice one, and I did it wrong the last at least three or four years. Every time I installed a multi-node deployment, so a clustered environment with multiple connections nodes and a proxy or HTTP server in front, I changed the seedless URL from HTTPS localhost to the endpoint, to my endpoint URL. So the URL the user is using to be sure that the URL is accessible in case one of the nodes is not anymore working anymore. So I changed it at least to, I don't know, CNX panagenda.local to be sure that it's working if my first node is going down. Yeah, but this is a problem. So if you put in a server name which is not localhost, it will using HTTP or HTTPS connections to access this seed list, which is fine. But it's using an older code, and the older code is not supporting TLS 1.2. The default setting, which is HTTPS localhost, is working completely different. It is not doing a HTTP connection. It's doing an internal communication directly within the WebSphere to get the catalog seedless information. So it's not HTTP based. It's multi-node, it supports multi-node environments. So it's everything is fine if you just use the default setting, which is HTTP localhost, with the information behind that it's not using localhost and it's not using HTTPS. It's only using internal tasks and it's working with multi-node environment. So do not change the catalog seedless URL in your environment. Yeah. Second one about seedless. In this case, the search seedless, not the catalog seedless. There's a validation URL and a validation wsadmin call, which you can use to validate your seedless if everything is working, if you have errors within your seedless and so on, which is really nice and which I used for some monitoring stuff. So I called the wsadmin script every 10 minutes to be sure that the seedless are working and the seedless are up to date and my search index is up to date, which is working and it's really fine. But the problem is the seedless validation will create new seedless files and will store them on your hard disk, which, yeah, in a big environment, it could be, I don't know, 200, 400, 500 megabyte for every run, but the validation will not delete it. So if you run the validation every 10 minutes, you will get 500 megabytes every 10 minutes on top until your hard disk is full. So if you would like to use the validation, be sure to create a script to delete and remove the validation seedless files. If not, your hard disk will be filled up and your system will be breakdown. Yeah, textbox.io, the new textbox editor within connections. If you go through the documentation or the installation guide, it will mention that you should create an application configuration file and store it in the root directory of your installation, which means on Windows, you need to store it on the C drive in the root directory or on the D drive in the root directory. On Linux, I think it's /opt and directory within /opt in the root directory, you need to create the application config file, where you put in some information about your configuration and your environment. Yeah, this is not really nice if you store an application file, which is really important, directly in the root directory. So perhaps a colleague will delete it or move it, or I don't know. So a better option would be to use Java generic properties for this configuration and put in the three lines into your Java generic properties for the application server, which is which textbox.io was running on. So just put in the three lines, restart your application server, and textbox.io will work and will be configured. If you have connection 6 or 5.5.0.2, please only copy the first two lines, because the third line will load some old code, which is not good. So it's the three lines is only needed for 5.5.0.1 and earlier. Yeah, Spinego signals on and connections. There is a problem if a user is part of too many groups in the Active Directory. The problem is that all groups, all the memberships of a user are stored in the token which is needed for the single sign-on. And this token is stored in the header, in the HTTP header, and the header is limited to 8192 bits, which might be too less for a user with really many group memberships. So, and if the header is too small for the group memberships, the single sign-on will not work. So you can change this with only one line in your configuration and just add limit request field size, and the maximum is 16,384. Into your HTTP config and restart your HTTP server, and everything will be fixed and fine. And the main problem with this is that mostly your VIP users will have this issue, because the VIP users will be users with the most memberships in your environment. So at least just configure it, or before you go in production, talk to one of your VIPs if everything is working. So it's mostly a VIP thing. Yeah, a performance thing is tuning your databases. So I saw it very often in different environments that the DB2 databases are not maintained, which means the DB2 database will be getting really slow after some time. And yeah, you need to maintain it to get a smooth running and fast running database. There are some scripts within connections. You will find it in the connections root directory, xkit connection SQL directory, or in your wizard installation directory. You will have a folder for every database, and within the folders you will find a runstat and a reoc script for every database for connections. So you need to just run them regularly. I don't know, every week, every month. It's a little bit depending on your environment. So perhaps if your users are heavily using files, you might run files twice a week. It really depends on your environment. You need to recheck this. But yeah, it's really important to run them. And it's also important to run them in a specific order. First, you need to run a runstat script, then the reoc script, and then once again, the runstat. This one is really important. And yeah, perhaps you have third-party databases in your environment, like, I don't know, Docs or Forms Experience Builder. And for those databases, IBM does not provide any maintenance script. So you need to build your own ones. And I built a small script, which is at the moment only running on Linux, which you can use to create those maintenance tasks for all databases which are part of your DB2 instance. So you need to run it on Linux to get the scripts The maintenance script itself can be started on every environment. So they will also work on on Windows and Linux, of course. So you can just download the code from my blog and use it. And you will see that your UI connections UI will be faster afterwards. It's really important. Yeah, download connection software. So if you install a new environment with Connection 6, you can use this tech note from IBM, which provides a list of all part numbers for your software you will need. So it's a good starting point. Of course, you will not find all of the software because everything which is on Fix Central, so Fix Packs or me and other stuff, does not have a part number and is not included in this tech note, but it's a good starting point to find your software and to download your software. TLS 1.2 only environments. With Connection 6 and all the Connections 5.5 tier 2, you are able to configure a TLS 1.2 only environment for security reasons. For Connection 6, everything's fine. For Connections 5.5 tier 2, you need to be sure that you use the latest textbox I/O, the latest Forms Experience Builder version, and the WebSphere 8.5.5 Fixpack 9. Then also the runtime is running and everything's fine. For the file, if you use a CCM and FileNet, you will have a problem while installing and updating your environment because the config manager does not support TLS. It needs SSL version 3 connection. For docs, you need at least version 2 CR1 Interim Fix 7. And for Connection 6, which needs Java 1.8, you need to define a Java generic property in all your application servers, Node Agent, and for the deploy manager to be sure that they can speak TLS 1.2 only. If you have Connection 5.5 CR1 or earlier, please do not configure TLS 1.2. It's really hard. You will have many, many problems. So I really do not recommend this. But you will find some more information on my blog if you would like to do it. Yeah, tuning your search index. So it's often a problem at customer side that users do not find the content in connections. So you can do some small configs to get a better search index. First of all, only use one language within the search directory. If you configure two language in the directory, search directory, your users will not find any content anymore. It's an issue within Connections 2.5, and it's not fixed, so do not use it. Then you have two configurations. For example, the 1-2-2 matching, which enabled you to find the term umlauts. And the other option would be to integrate or to install the connections type ahead search, which allows you to get a nicer UI, a better UI user experience. If the user will type in the search field, he will get results while typing depending on his history, so on his last search and his last access data. And you will find faster find his results. So this is based on Apache Solr, and it's a small installation, but it's really cool, and it's really cool. Tip 15, OrientMe sizing. So if you install a new OrientMe environment, be sure to check or recheck the information IBM provides about sizing. So for every CFC master and boot and proxy node, you will need at least 4 CPUs and 8 gigabit RAM. For every worker node, you need at least 8 CPUs and 24 gigabit RAM. And you also need storage for the persistent data, for all nodes, and so on. So recheck all the configuration. If you would like to build a smaller development or test environment, you will have problems to install OrientMe with less than 8 cores. It's possible to downsize the whole environment, but it's completely unsupported. So it's really not a good thing for a production environment, but for a development environment, you can downsize the whole installation to run it with two or four cores. You'll find some informational scripts on my blog, but it's really not for production. For production, please check the documentation from IBM and put in the resources you need. Yeah, employee extended role. The employee extended role is needed for connections users, which should be able to work with external users in your environment. If you would like to enable all of your users, or at least all of your users, it's really hard because you enable it using a WSAdmin script, and you need to put in the email address of every user and enable every user once by once. Another option would be to use the profile service set batch role script and put in a text file with all mail addresses of your users. So you can enable all your users with only one WSAdmin call. Another option would be to change this within the database, but it's not supported, so it's better to use the WSAdmin script to do it. Textbox spell checking. If you enable spell checking with Textbox.io, you will get an issue with Chrome, because for the Chrome extension integration, you will need to put in your root certificate or your trusted root certificate into the Java certificate store to be able that WebSphere can trust it. So just put in it into the CR cert store, which is located in your Java directory, and restart your WebSphere environment, and it will work. If not, you will get a HTTP 500. So yeah, please recheck in your existing environments if it will work with Google Chrome. And once again, the CR cert store is part of the Java directory. So if you update your Java, your WebSphere Java, be sure to back up and restore the certificate store afterwards. Read-only and writable profile fields. There's something I found really often at customer side, that profile fields, which are synced with the LDAP directory, are also writable within connections. So at least let's say you have the office number, and the office number will be synchronized through LDAP into connections, but the user is able to change it. So the user will put in a different number in his profile and save it. And I don't know, after 2 hours or 4 hours after the next TDI synchronization task, the number will be overwritten with the default in the LDAP directory. And the user is asking him, hey, why does it does not change? Why does my email address office number isn't changed? And it's rechanged every 4 hours. So please recheck your configuration. Everything which is synchronized from the LDAP directory should be read-only in the connections profile. Yeah, if you have issue with the FileNet administration interface, browser interface, and the login isn't working anymore, recheck your HTTP configuration, the HTTP config file. If you exclude the URL within your deflate configuration or mod deflate configuration or gzip configuration. So if you use mod deflate with the FileNet administrative interface UI URL, it will not work. So the login will not work. And it's only support English language. So also change your browser to the English language, and then you will be able to log in. Next tip, surveys. Same here, the service setup dialog within your browser, which is started on every new installation or on every update, is also English only. So if you have a non-English browser, the setup will not work. You will get an error message, and you will not be able to finish the installation. So be sure to use the English browser or just download a portable Firefox in English and use this one. Yeah, post-upgrade task. When you install iFixes or CRs for connections, be sure to clear your temp directories for every node afterwards. If not, you will get nice UI bugs. So you will get a UI based on connections 4.5 or at least 5, and you will get other bugs and your user will be unhappy. So if you install iFix or CR, clear /temp and /wstemp in every application server profile on every node. And of course, be sure to only clear the temp file and wstemp file. If not, you can search for backup. Yeah, if you have Connections Content Manager, CCM, and would like to debug your environment and you are unable to log into the admin interface where you define your debugging parameters, a second option would be to put in some values in your Java generic properties for the CCM application server, for the FileNet application server, and also copy over or customize a default log4j XML file, which is part of your installation directory. And you can customize this file and put in your tracing information or debugging settings you would like to have, and restart your application server, and you will get your debugging as the same as you would like to enable it in the graphical UI. But if it's not possible in the UI because the installation is not working and you have no UI, you can use Java generic properties to enable traces. And you will find some more information on my blog, which also include all the possible tracing parameters which you could enable. Yeah, HTTP server compression. It's also performs thingy, so you should enable HTTP compression or more deflate on an HTTP server. It's really, you will get a better performance. And this one is are my default settings, so it just can copy them over and use them. Yeah, another upgrade thingy, if you update FileNet, so CCM or docs and viewer, be sure to remap your applications to the HTTP server afterwards. If not, your docs installation or your CCM installation will not be available for your users anymore afterwards. So please recheck all applications and recheck if they are mapped to the HTTP server. If so, everything is fine. If not, please remap them, recreate your plugin, and everything will work afterwards. Also very important, after installation and also after updates, recheck your Lotus Connections configuration file if docs and viewer is configured directly. So if the HTTP and the HTTPS link is defined to your endpoint URL, and also if the inter-service URL is configured for both. If not, you may have some issues with the CCM integration and with the file preview integration in the activity stream. So if you have issues with CCM integration and file preview integration in the activity stream, recheck your Lotus Connections config and recheck if inter-service URL is configured. Also recheck after every update. Yeah, if you would like to deploy a new RDME environment, you should always use the latest fixes. So, for example, version 6.0.2 included a fix which defined a specific Docker version. So if you would like to install an older version, so 6 or 6.0.1 at the moment, the whole installation will break because it will install a Docker version which is not supported at the moment. So you should, every time you install RDME, just use the latest version. And it's really better because the update process at the moment is an uninstall and reinstall. So if you install version 6.1 and would like to update to 6.2, it's a reinstallation. So we will deinstall 6.1 and reinstall 6.2. So it does not make any sense to use the older version and then update to a newer version. Just use the latest version and everything's fine. And recheck your mount points before installing. It's really hard to move the Docker directory after you installed and configured containers and pods and Kubernetes. Yeah, deleting communities using the REST API. This one is also a monitoring thingy. If you would like to create communities and delete communities using your monitoring system to check if your connections environment is working, it's a good idea, but be sure to delete the community twice. So the first delete REST call will put the community into the trash, and there the community will stay for 90 days. So if you do it every 10 minutes, you will have every 10 minutes a community which will restore 90 days in the trash, which is not really good. So at least call the delete command twice, because the second delete call will completely delete the community from the trash. So it's the community is gone. So if you would like to use the REST and would like to completely delete the community, just call the delete command twice. Yeah, if you update your connections to a newer CR level or to a iFix version where database upgrade is needed, you should recheck your numDB value afterwards. Why? All updates, database updates IBM provides, rechecking the numDB value and assessing the numDB value to a value which is good for connections. But if you have third-party integrations like Doc, LuxFormed Experience Builder, and some others, you might need a higher numDB value than the normal connections value. So the value might be too less, and your web environment might be unable to connect to all databases. So verify the numDB value every time after every database update to be sure that the value is working for your environment. Also a good one for all Oracle users or Oracle environments. If you create your databases, the database script will also create database users within Oracle. Those users will get the default profile. The problem is that the default profile is limited, or the password expiration for the default profile is limited to 1 year. So the installation will work, everything is fine, and after 1 year, your whole connections environment will stop working because the default password is limited to 1 year only. So just create a different profile without a password expiration, or change the default profile and define unlimited as value, and everything is fine. But change the default configuration. Yeah, user synchronization when using TDI or the TDI solution directory. So you have different options. For issues related to the user synchronization and to connections and to the profile APIs, you have debug informations within the profile TDI properties. You can debug the source LDAP. You can debug the profile update, the manager sync, the collection task. You can debug the JavaScript within your TDI sole. So it's the first one is really the connections part of the TDI sole. If you have TDI issues, like you are unable to connect because your SSL certificate is not trusted or other TDI related things, you can enable debugging in the log4j properties files within the TDI sole directory. This one would be for really the TDI specific issues. And just for information, within the profile STDI property file, you have a property called sync updates clean temp files, which is true by default. You can set it to false. Then the TDI will not delete the temp files, which mean that you have a folder in your TDI solver which is called sync updates, and within this folder you will find the complete export of your LDAP and your PeopleDB employee table in files. So it's really good for doing debugging. You have your complete LDAP export and a complete database profiles export in the files team, and can compare and can check the values and so on. But please reset the value afterwards. Yeah, issue when you use connections docs with UNC paths. There's the issue with the backslash and slashes in the configuration or in the installation scripts. So after you install connections docs based on UNC drives, you need to be sure and check your WebSphere variables that the slashes have to be forward slashes. And the important thing, you also need to reconfigure your zip engine XML, because in this one it needs to be backward slashes. And you need to change it. If not, your stores will not be saved in the UNC path. They will be saved on your local storage, which is not good in a multi-node environment. So thanks for Victor, who blocked this a year ago. It's really important. Another DB2 issue. If you install a new DB2 environment, you will get a test license which is working for 90 days. So 90 days everything is fine, and after 90 days your DB2 will stop working because it's unlicensed. So recheck your environment if you have a working license file, or if you ported a license file. It's only one command, DB2 license minus L, and just need to check the expire date and everything is fine. If you have a cluster DB2 environment using the Tivoli tsum scripts, you also need to upgrade your licenses after updating to DB2 version 10.5 Fixpack 8, which is a supported version for connections 5.5. If not, your whole cluster scripts will not work anymore. It's really important in cluster environments. Yeah, if you have an issue with your Windows plugins for connections, so the plugins which are integrated in the Explorer or for the synchronization, and you would like to debug those, you will find an application called DHRace in every installation. You just need to start it, reproduce the issue, and then you can export or save the traces using these applications, and have a look into them, or debug, or send them to IBM or your business partner to check what the issue is. So just starting the application, reproducing the error, and exporting the traces. Yeah, security of your HTTP server. If you have an external environment which is available in the internet, and do not use a proxy or HTTP server in front, which would be recommended, you need to be sure that your HTTP server config is secure. So please recheck your Cypher configuration. The first one is a good configuration, so we get on SSL Labs AA in your SSL Labs check, and the last two ones you will need to support connections with TLS 1.1 or earlier, which is needed for Node 8.5 client. So if you have a Node 8.5 client with connections widgets integrated, you will need to add those ciphers too, which then you will get on SSL Labs, you will get a minus, but it's still okay, better than using the default configuration. Yeah, connections browser push notification. This is a new feature which was available with connections 5.5, and of course it's part of connection 6. There's a new app which is called push notifications, and it's not used for the push notification for iOS or Android devices. It's used for the push notifications for all browsers. So how does it work? The client will send a post request to connections or to the HTTP server. The server will hold the request open to send over responses to the client, so push notifications to the client. But there's a timer on the HTTP server, which is by default 10 minutes. So after 10 minutes, the request or the client request will be timed out, and the client will resend a new post request immediately. So every client has at least one connections to your environment only for the push notification stuff. And every time, so if your browser is not used at the moment, but it's open and connections is open in the tab, you will have a connections to your HTTP server. If your user uses Internet Explorer, Firefox, and Chrome, and all three are open and connections is open, you will have three connections to your environment for this only this user. So it might be really a big problem and bigger environment. So you should recheck your HTTP config and the thread limits. You should recheck your web container thread pool on every application server and on your WebC plugins. And with connection 6, you have the option to use the Nginx HTTP server for those long polling post requests. Though the Nginx server has the capability to work with the long pull requests better than the Apache, and the IBM HTTP server is an Apache server, so it's also an option. Or just reconfigure your proxy server in front of your environment, but recheck those settings. Yeah, customize your log language. If you have German Windows server or German Linux server, all your WebC logs will be in German, which is might not be good when debugging stuff, when you like to create a PMR or to search some stuff in the internet. English logs are better. So you can use a Java generic property, which you can put in all Java virtual machines, so every application server, every node agent, and just put in user language and user region. And it's really important to use both. So if you have only the region and put it to US, you might get a DE for German as language and a region US. And this will break down your whole environment. So please be sure to add both and add them to every Java virtual machine. Same for the TDI. There it's you can add it as part of the IBM DI server batch file or script, and just put in the same configuration. Yeah, proxy configuration. If you would like to enable the proxy on a HTTP server, which you need for me and some other stuff, be sure to configure it securely. So it's really important to put in the proxy request off in your configuration. If not, we'll have a nice forwarding proxy and everyone is able to talk to systems behind your HTTP server, which is not really nice. So be sure to add the proxy requests off into your configuration. Log rotation. So also very important, please recheck your environment and recheck if your log rotation is configured without any issues. So in WebC, we had an issue with connections 5.5 or the installer with connections 5.5. There was an issue that the log rotation wasn't configured correctly. So please recheck it if you have connections 5.5. With connection 6, everything is fine. For DB2, I would recommend to update your configuration to define the size of the DX size, the DX log size, to be sure that you can open the log file. So normally, if I talk to a customer, to a new customer and he has a DB2 issue, we need to check the DB2 DR log file, but we are unable to open it because it's, I don't know, 2 or 3 gigabytes, and no editor can open it anymore. So recheck your configuration, same for the TDI, and of course the HTTP server. You can just use lock rotate, rotate locks on your Linux environment or Windows environment for the HTTP server, and define a cron job to gzip your log files or move your log files or remove your log files depending on your environment. Yeah, if you would like to use RNME with Spinneo single sign-on, it will not work by default. You need to define one setting within your Kubernetes configuration. So you need to change your config map and rechange the IC connections URL to the URL /social/auth/blue authentication. That's really important. And afterwards, you need to redeploy the all RNME web client pods and all important to Miba services pods. And afterwards, your things are on with Spinego will work. If you would like to monitoring your WebC application server, you have plenty of options, but there are two really nice ones. So the first one is PMI. It's included within WebSphere. You just need to activate it, and you can get WebSphere-related stuff, connections pool size, heap sizes, and other stuff related to the WebSphere environment, and can reconfigure or recheck your settings. It's really cool. If you would like to get some more information, so full stack information about CPU, I/O, Java runtime, threads, or your host system, you could using the IBM Health Center. It's it's a small Java application which needs to be added to your WebSphere environment and needs to be activated through the Java generic properties, and then you can access a port with your Health Center client and recheck all your information on your WebSphere environment. So both are really helpful. The fast one is the PMI, and the Health Center needs some configuration, but also have some more information. Yeah. Also, a thing which is part of connections since years, you can define custom profile types. So if you would like to have different profiles, at least so the first profile should include some third-party widgets, and the second profile should be the default profile. You can customize your environment. So you just define a custom profile and define a configuration, and say, okay, this third-party widget should be part of it, and this widget shouldn't be part of it. It's really important that you be sure that you, when you config the widget config XML, which needs to be customized to define which widgets should be part of the profile and which not, it's really important that the default profile needs to be the latest one. So connections will stop looking at the configuration after the default profile. So if you put in something after the default profile, it's not part of your runtime. So put in your custom profiles, but the default needs to be the last one. Yeah, another RNME thing. If you have a HTTPS only environment, which is at the moment, I think, the default setting when you, or should be the default when you're installing a new connections environment, you need to be sure that your config map also includes the inter-service port 443 and the inter-service scheme HTTPS for the inter-service and also for the RNME CNX port and scheme. Afterwards, once again, redeploy all RNME web client ports and important to Miba service ports, and everything is working. Thanks to Charlie Price, he's part of the support team at IBM, and he blogged about it some month ago. Yeah, a mobile push and proxy configuration. So if you would like to use mobile push notifications with your environment and iOS and Android, it's possible, but you need internet access. So your connections environment needs to talk to the Apple Gateway or the Google Gateway. but it's possible to use proxy configuration. So if direct internet access is not working, you can reconfigure your proxy host, your proxy port, and also configure authentication for your proxy, and just restart your environment, and your connections environment will be able to talk to your push gateways. So I think it was included in connections 5.5. Yeah, another security setting. It's mainly a problem with newer Domino versions and main integration, because with newer Domino versions, IBM enabled Domino to support 4,000-bit DH key size, which is good, which is secure, but WebSphere is unable to talk to Domino afterwards. So if you have a problem with mail integration or any integration between WebSphere and Domino, and you update it to at least Domino 9.01 FP4 interim fix 2, and the integration is stopped working, you need to put in a nodes any setting, which is SSL, DH key size 2048, and restart your Domino, or at least the HTTP server, and afterwards WebSphere is able to talk to the Domino. So it's a WebSphere problem. WebSphere only supports 2,000-bit keys or less. And thanks for Ben for posting it. Yeah, it's an older thing, but it's still important. With connections 5.5.0.2, IBM changed the content route for the server integration in connection from /forms to /surveys. So I would recommend to put in a short rewrite in your HTTP config to be sure that if there are old links out at the users, bookmarks, etc., with the old forms link, that they are still working with the new service link and rewritten on the HTTP server. So just put in this line, restart your HTTP server, and the old links will work. Yeah, WSAdmin on Linux. Yeah, it's a problem with WSAdmin and also DB2 or the SQL plus Oracle client. You won't be able to use history and the error keys within a WSAdmin session on Linux, which is really bad. On Windows, it's possible. On Linux, it's not possible. So there's a small wrapper which is available to download for free, and with this wrapper, you can start WSAdmin or the DB2 command, and afterwards you will be able to work with the history of the error keys, which is really helpful if you need to do some stuff with WSAdmin or DB2. Yeah, LDAP groups on WebSphere with the Domino directory. So if you have a Domino directory in WebSphere, and you would like to use groups, your base DN needs to be empty, because a group is not hierarchical, it's a plane. So if you have a group, you need to remove your base DN. If you would like to include a second directory for external users or for other department, which is also Domino based, and you also need groups in this, you will get a problem, because you will not be able to define two directory Domino directories and clear the base DN in both. It does not work in the UI. So you might have a problem. How you can fix it, but you need to fix this manually in the configuration file, not in the UI. So you need to open the winconfig XML file, or first of all, you need to back up the winconfig XML file, which is really important, because if you have an error, your whole WebSphere environment might not be starting again. So backup the vimconfig XML, and then open it and search for your base entry. So you will get a base entry name, your name, the name in repository, which is your base DN, and just remove the base DN. It's only one line for every repository. So if you have two repositories, you need to change two lines. If you have three repositories, you need to change three lines. Save the configuration, sync your nodes, and restart your environment, and you will be able to use groups in all domino directories. Yeah, monitoring IBM HTTP server. There's a nice module, which is called mod status, which you can enable on HTTP servers to get some insights about your HTTP server. So how many open connections and so on. So to do so, you just need to add a location into your HTTP server and define some security paths. And it's really important to define order, deny, allow, and then allow the access from localhost or from an internal directory or admin from an internal network or admin network or something else. If you skip the line, the slash server status page will be available for all users which are able to access the HTTP server, which is not really good because you will get many, many informations. But it's good to get some insights about the HTTP server and if you need to customize some settings and so on. So just have a look into it and reconfigure your environment. Yeah, some basics. The connections admin role. It's a web role, which the a user is defined. This user could be a WebSphere local repository user or a LLAP user. And this is a problem. There are some installations where the user is a AWS admin, which is the default local WebSphere administrator, and you will get some issues. So with older versions, you had some issues with thumbnail generation in the galleries. With connections 5.5, you have issues with CCM and docs, and also with CCM migrations, you will have some issues. So I just recommend to use a LLAP user as connections admin. So it's better. You will not have any problems, and of course you can change the user. So if you installed as AWS admin with connections as connections admin, you can change it to an LLAP user. It's a little bit of work, but it's possible. So I included the link for you. Yeah. So tip 50. If you define custom widgets in a widgets config XML, and you define some custom files which are located in your connections customization directory or your provision directory, which are needed by the plugin, be sure to use WebSphere variables. So it's better to use WebSphere variables because, I don't know, let's say you add a custom widgets and 1 year later, you need to change the path of your connection share directory. You will change your share directory, you will have a look in the documentation, you will find, okay, I need to change this and this and then this and this for connections itself, but you will miss your custom widget and your custom widget will break down because it's unable to connect to its to find his files, its files. So just use the same WebSphere variables and connections uses, and if you change them, connections will be fine and your custom widget will be fine. So, and our last tip is related to OrientMe. There's a problem in all OrientMe versions out there at the moment, which might cause a full disk space because Elasticsearch index grow up because you have errors and your logs will be indexed using Elasticsearch. So if you have errors, your Elasticsearch will getting big until your disk is full. This is a bug which is related to a storage driver, with a default storage driver, which is included in the Docker installation. So there's a short-term solution, which would be to create a cron job, which launches a script within the Elasticsearch container and purge your data after 2 days. So just run this script, which is not running by default. The second one is to change your storage driver from device mapper From overlay to device mapper, device mapper is also a supported one for Red Hat and ZOS, supported by Docker itself. And problem is you need to reinstall your whole environment to change the storage driver. And at the moment, the storage driver device mapper is not supported by IBM for ORNME, but it will be supported in later versions. So to fix the root cause, you need to change your storage driver to device mapper. As short-term solution, you can create a short script, which is posted on Steps blog, to schedule the deletion of the Elasticsearch index every night or every X hours. Yeah. Okay. So are there any questions?
All right. Thank you very much, Nico. We are already actually out of time, so we're going to have to skip the Q&A for today, but I already indicated also in the webinar chat that the questions that have been posed will be answered in an individual email. To those of you who will be implementing some of those tips, if you're having trouble doing so, I'm sure, Nico, they can contact you using any of the contact details you posted in the third slide. Is that correct?
Yeah, of course.
Fantastic. All right, so with that, I'd like to thank everyone for joining us today. Reminder to keep an eye on our webinar page for the upcoming webinars, including the third in the Social Connections 12 series, which is titled Reboot 2.0, How's Your Digital Transformation Going? That's on the 6th of December with Luis Suarez. And you will also find all the recordings, including this one, on that webinar page. So I'll give the last word to you, Nico, and then I will end the webinar recording.
Okay, thanks, Daniel. Yeah, thanks everyone for joining, and yeah, let me know if you have any further questions, and just contact me by email, Twitter, I don't know. Thanks a lot, and bye.